Let's talk about RF filter basics. When we talk about a filter, what we're looking for is something that controls the frequencies that come out based on the frequencies that go in, or those that hit the load based on those coming from the generator. So we define that in terms of the frequency response or the transfer function, which we call H of omega. Omega, of course, is the frequency, where omega is 2 pi times the frequency in hertz. And that is defined as the voltage that comes out, which is the voltage at the load, divided by the voltage that goes in, or the voltage at the generator. So this is the frequency response, and we can define that either in terms of a linear value or in terms of decibels. When we define it in terms of decibels, we normally talk about alpha, or the attenuation, as a function of frequency, and we define that based on power. So we're going to use a 20 log, and that's going to be 1 over H of omega. So that's how we define the frequency response or the transfer function. Now with that, there are several types of filters. And when we consider different types, what we're really talking about is what comes out. We're interested in the output. So for example, a low pass filter right here, when we define H of omega, and we want to be able to pass low frequencies, we're going to be able to say they pass, and then there's a cutoff frequency after which none of them come out and the output is zero. The frequency right here is called the cutoff frequency. This is a low-pass filter. A high-pass filter, by comparison, will pass high frequencies, but not low frequencies. So here's a high-pass filter. A band-pass filter will pass a specific band, going from omega 1 to omega 2. And this is a band-pass filter. Or we might have a notch or band-reject filter, where we pass everything except for a few frequencies here in the middle, and so this would be a band stop or a band reject or a notch filter. Now, in the real world, we can't really produce a filter where the frequency passes completely and then drops off suddenly. That would be a brick wall filter, and we'd love to have that, but it's not possible. More realistically, our filter goes something like this. In that case, we have to define a cutoff frequency, and how are we going to define a cutoff when we have something that's changing in this way? So what we normally do is that we say, this is the 3 dB cutoff, and that is where the decibel value of H of omega has dropped by 3 decibels. So the way we calculate that is we take H of omega, take its log, and multiply that by 10, because we're still talking about the voltage, and that is going to be a decibel value. When that is minus 3 dB, that gives us the cutoff frequency. Now this type of filter right here, we would call maximally flat. That means that we don't have any ripples along here. It's about the flattest type of filter we can make. So I'm going to draw that picture right here. Again, this is a maximally flat filter, or it's a Butterworth filter. We have other types of filters too. For example, we might want to be able to come down steeper, but in order for us to come down steeper, we're actually going to have some ripple here. And this would be called a Chebyshev. Or we might want a filter where we don't have such large ripples, but we have smaller ripples here, and also smaller ripples down here. This is an elliptic filter. Now, each of these types of filters are useful and are designed in slightly different ways. When we cover one of these designs, you'll quickly see how to do the other designs as well. So now let's talk about the properties of this filter. So we've already said that we're going to have something which gives us a 3 dB cutoff frequency right here. So that's the 3 dB cutoff frequency. We also would define the magnitude of the ripple. And then finally, we would define something called the insertion loss, which is right here where we define a particular value such as minus 60 dB. And we call that the insertion loss. And then we'd have a frequency at which that insertion loss occurs. So that tells us something about the angle of how this filter comes down. So those are some of the basic parameters where we define this type of filter. Now, if we have a band pass or a band reject filter, there are two other things that we're going to be looking at. So we've got this omega 1 and omega 2. That's the bandwidth. but we also define fractional bandwidth, and that is defined as omega 2 minus omega 1 divided by the square root of omega 1 omega 2. That's the fractional bandwidth, and if we want that in terms of percent, we multiply that by 100 in order to get the fractional bandwidth in percent. Now let's talk about how we implement a filter. Let's consider that we want to be able to have a frequency go through this resistor. Resistors allow every frequency to go through until the resistance gets too big. When the resistance starts to approach infinity, it's an open circuit, and no frequency gets through. Now let's consider an inductor. The impedance of an inductor is J omega L. So what happens as omega starts to get really big? In this case, then ZL would start to approach infinity. This would start to look like an open circuit, and high frequencies wouldn't make it through. So an inductor is a low-pass device. A capacitor, by comparison, is 1 over J omega C. So when omega is very small, that's when the impedance of the capacitor starts to approach infinity, and that's when it looks like an open circuit. So a capacitor is a high-pass device. Well, what about bandpass? So if we want to be able to have a bandpass filter, something like this, where it passes frequencies from omega 1 to omega 2, we need to be able to design something that allows some low frequencies to get through and some high frequencies. So we're certainly going to need a low-pass element, and then also along this path, we need to be able to have a high-pass element. So what we do is we replace all of the elements in the circuit with something that looks like this in the places that we want them to pass. So when we design a circuit, it's really common that we'll design a low-pass circuit that looks something like this, an inductor, and then resonate that with a capacitor, and that will allow low frequencies to get through. If we want to convert that to a bandpass design, right here in the path where we have the inductor, we'll replace that with this inductor and capacitor combo, like so. Then right here where we have the series element, we're actually going to replace that with an inductor and a capacitor in series, like this. So this is how we convert from a low-pass design to a bandpass design. Now what about a band reject? In a band reject, we would want to make sure that some high frequencies didn't get through and some low frequencies didn't get through. So we would design this same filter in this way. And this would be a band stop or a band reject filter. Finally, let's talk about the order of a filter. If we want to do a low-pass filter design that looks something like this, sometimes we want to be able to make it steeper, like this. In order to do that, we need to increase the order of the filter, using more elements in order to be able to make a faster cutoff for our filter. So the simplest filter that we can do is something like this. And the way we define this is we count how many elements are. There's an L1 and a C2, so the order of this filter is 2. We could change this to something that might have more elements, an L, like 2 inductors and 2 capacitors. This would be an N equals 4, because we have an L1, a C2, L3 and a C4, so that has an N equal 4. We also can make filters that might have an odd number of elements, like this. Here's an N equals 5 filter, and it's also okay to swap the elements around. So we might have had capacitance, inductance, like this, capacitance, inductance, capacitance. What's the order of this filter? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is an N equals 5, and then this is an N equal 5. The larger order, the steeper the descent on our filters. If we're doing a filter that has ripples, typically when we get a steeper descent, we also get higher ripples. So that's what we want to know about the order of the filter. In the next set of lectures, what we're going to look at is how to actually change the filter designs into Butterworth and Chebyshev components and define the values of the inductors and capacitors that we need.